play accurately. Anyone can play accurately. I want an expression. As far as the piano is concerned, sentiment is my forte. I keep science alive. Yes, sir. And speaking of science alive, have you had the cucumber salad just cut from any broccoli?
Yes, sir.
Oh. And by the way, then, I see from your books that on Thursday night, when Lord Sherman and Mr. Worthing were dining with me, that 8 bottles of champagne were ended as being consumed.
Yes, sir. 8 bottles and a pint.
Why is it that at a bachelor's establishment, the servants invariably drink the champagne? I ask merely for information.
Well, I often observe that in a married household, champagne is rarely a first-rate brand.
Good heavens! Is marriage so demoralizing as that?
I have little experience of present, sir. I've only been married once. That was in misunderstanding between myself and a very, very young person.
I'm not too sure that I'm interested in your family life, May.
It's not a very interesting subject. I never think of it myself.
But very natural, I am sure. That'll be all, May. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Earnest Worthing, sir.
Oh, how are you, my dear Earnest? What bring you to town?
Oh, pleasure, pleasure. What else should bring one anywhere? Meeting as usual, I see, Archie.
I believe it is customary in good society to take some slight refreshment at 5 o'clock. Where have you been since last Thursday?
Oh, in the country, in the country.
What on earth do you do there?
When one is in town, one amuses oneself. When one is in the country, one amuses other people. It is excessively boring.
And who are these people that you amuse?
Oh, neighbors, neighbors.
You have nice neighbors and you're from Shropshire?
Perfectly horrid. Never speak to one of them.
Oh, how mentally you must amuse them. Now, Shropshire is your county, is it not?
Ah, yes, Shropshire. Hello. Why all these cups? Why cucumber sandwiches? Why such reckless extravagance in one so young? Who's coming to tea?
I am merely Aunt Augusta and Gwendolyn.
Oh, how perfectly delightful.
Yes, it is all very well indeed, but I don't think that Aunt Augusta will quite approve of you being here.
May I ask why?
But my dear fellow, the way that you flirt with Gwendolyn is perfectly disgraceful. It is almost as bad as the way Gwendolyn flirts with you.
I am in love with Gwendolyn. I have come up to town expressly to propose to her.
I thought you'd come up here for business. I call that pleasure.
Oh, how utterly unromantic you are.
I really don't see anything romantic in proposing. It is very romantic to be in love, but there is nothing romantic about a definite proposal. Why wouldn't it be accepted? One usually is, I believe. Then the excitement is over. The very essence of romance becomes uncertainty. If ever I was married, I'll try to forget that fact.
Oh, I have no doubt about that.
Please do not touch the cucumber sandwiches. They are ordered specially for Aunt Augusta.
Well, you've been eating them all the time.
Well, yes, that is a perfectly different matter. She is my aunt. Have some bread and butter. The bread and butter is from Gwendolyn. Gwendolyn is devoted to bread and butter.
True, and very good bread and butter it is, too.
Well, you need not eat it if you're going to eat at all. You act as if you are married to Gwendolyn already. You are not married to Gwendolyn already, and I doubt that you ever will be.
May I ask why?
My dear fellow, girls never marry the people they flirt with. Girls don't even rot.
That is perfectly absurd.
It isn't. It is a great truth. It accounts for the extraordinary number of bachelors that one sees all over the place. In the second place, I don't give my consent.
Your consent?
My dear fellow, Gwendolyn is my first cousin. Before I can allow you to marry her, we must clear up this whole question of Cecily.
Cecily? What on earth do you mean, Algie, by Cecily? I do not know anybody of that name.
Bring me the cigarette case that Mr. Worthing left in the smoking room last time we dined with him.
Yes, sir. You mean to say you?
have had my cigarette case this whole time.
Well, I wish to God you would have
let me know. I've been writing frantic letters to Scotland Yard about it, and I was very nearly offering a large reward for his return.
Well, I wish you would offer one. I seem to be rather usually hard up.
Well, there's no use in offering a large reward now that the thing has been found.
That is rather mean of you, I must say. However, now that I look at the inscription inside, I find that the thing is not yours after all.
Of course it's mine. You've seen me with it 100 times. However, it's a very ungentlemanly thing to read what is written inside a private cigarette case.
You're as absurd to have a hard and fast rule about what one should and shouldn't read. Half of modern culture depends on what one shouldn't read.
Yes, I know that. But I'm not about to die old in modern culture. It is not something one should talk of in private. Just give me my cigarette case.
Yes, but this isn't your cigarette case. This case is a present from someone of the name of Cecily. And you have just said that you did not know anybody that name.
Well, if you really must know, Cecily happens to be my aunt.
Your aunt?
Yes, charming old lady she is too. Lives at Tunbridge Wells.
What if she is your aunt and is at Tunbridge Wells? Why does she call herself Little Cecily? From Little Cecily with her fondest love.
Well, really, what use is there in that? Some aunts may be tall, some aunts may not be tall. That doesn't matter that merely an aunt can decide for herself. You seem to think that every aunt should be exactly like your aunt, and that is absurd.
Yes, but why does your aunt call you her uncle? From Little Cecily, with her fondest love, to her dear Uncle Jack. And why an aunt, no matter what her size may be, she called her own nephew her uncle? I can't possibly count. Besides, your name isn't Jack at all. It's Earnest.
My name is not Earnest. It is Jack.
You have always told me that your name was Earnest. I have introduced you as Earnest. You answer to the name of Earnest. You look as if your name was Earnest. In fact, you are one of the most earnest-looking persons that I know. Absurd by now that you say your name is not Earnest. It is on your cards. Here is one of them. Mr. Earnest Worthing, V4, the Albany. I'll keep this as proof that your name is Earnest, if ever you attempt to deny it to me, or to Gwendolyn, or to anyone else.
Well, my name is Earnest, in the town, and Jack, in the country. And that cigarette case was given to me in the country.
Yes, but that's on account of your small Aunt Cecily, who calls you her dear uncle. Come on, boy, what about the thing out at once?
My dear fellow, you talk exactly as if you were a dentist. It is a very vulgar thing to talk like a dentist when one is not a dentist. It produces a very false impression.
Now go on, tell me that whole thing. I may mention that I've always suspected you of being a secret. Bunburyist. And I am quite sure of it now.
What on earth do you mean, Bunburyist?
I will reveal to you the meaning of this incomparable phrase as soon as you are kind enough to inform me why you are Earnest in town and Jack in the country.
Well, produce me my cigarette case first.
Here it is. Now produce your explanation in prayer. Think it's improbable.
My dear fellow, there is nothing improbable about my explanation at all. In fact, it is perfectly ordinary. Old Mr. Thomas Cardew, who adopted me when I was a little boy, made me in his will guardian to his granddaughter, Miss Cecily Cardew. Cecily, who addresses me as her uncle from motives of respect, you could not possibly appreciate, lives with me in the country under the charge of her admirable governess, Miss Prism.
Where is that place in the country, by the way?
That is no use to you. You are not going to be invited. But I can tell you quite candidly that the place is not in Shropshire.
Oh, I suspected as much. I have Bunbury in Shropshire on 2 separate occasions. Now go on, tell me that whole thing. Why are you Earnest in town and Jack in the country?
In order to get out of town, I have invented a very useful younger brother by the name of Earnest, who lives in the Albany. Earnest gets to the most dreadful of scrapes.
That, my dear boy, is the whole truth, pure and simple. The truth is rarely pure and never simple.
What you really are is a ponderist.
I was quite right in saying that you were a ponderist. In fact, you are one of the most best ponderists that I know.
What on earth do you mean?
You have invented a very useful little brother by the name of Earnest, so that you may go up to town as often as you like. I have invented a permanent invalid by the name of Bunbury, so that I may go down to the country whenever I choose. Bunbury is extraordinarily invaluable. For instance, if it wasn't for Bunbury's bad health, I wouldn't be able to die from illnesses tonight for him. I have really been engaged to Aunt Augusta for more than a week.
But I have not invited you to come with me to Willis's tonight.
I know. You are very foolish about not sending out invitations. People don't like not receiving invitations.
You have a much better time with your Aunt Augusta tonight.
I have no intention of doing anything but lie. To begin with, I dine with Aunt Augusta on Monday. And once a week is enough to dine with one's own relations. Besides, now that I know you to be a confirmed Bunburyist, I naturally want to talk to you about Bunbury. I want to tell you the rules.
But I'm not a Bunburyist at all. If Gwendolyn accepts me, I will have killed my brother. At any rate, I think I will have got rid of him anyway. Cecily is becoming a little bit too much interested in him, and it is becoming rather a bore. I strongly advise you to do the same about Mr. Oh, no, invalid friend, the absurd man.
Nothing will induce me to part with Bunbury. And if ever you get married, which seems to be extremely problematic, you will be very glad to know Bunbury indeed. A man who marries without knowing Bunbury has a very tedious time of it.
If I marry Gwendolyn, and she is the only one in my life that I ever saw that I would marry, I will certainly not want to know Mr. Bunbury.
And then your wife will. You don't seem to realize that in married life, three is company and two is none. Ah, that must be Aunt Augusta. Now, if I can get out of the way for more than 10 minutes, so that you may have an opportunity of proposing to Gwendolyn, may I dine with you at Willis's tonight?
I suppose if you really want to.
Yes, but you must be serious about it. I hate people who are not serious about meals. It is so very shallow of them.
Lady Bracknell and Miss Fairfax.
Good afternoon, my dear Algernon. I hope you find you behaving very well.
I'm doing very well, Augusta.
That's not quite the same thing. In fact, the two things rarely go together.
Tell me, you are smart.
I am always smart, aren't I, Mr. Worley?
You are quite perfect, Miss Fairfax.
Oh, I hope I'm not that. You would leave them before I have developments and I intend to develop in many directions. I'm sorry if you don't need to leave, Belgium. I was glad to come upon dear Lady Carberry. I've not been there since her poor husband's death. I've never seen a woman so completely altered. She looks some 20 years younger. But now, I have a nice cup of tea and one of those cucumber sandwiches you promised.
Oh, certainly, Aunt Augusta.
Come and sit here, won't you, Gwendolyn? Thanks, Mama. I'm quite comfortable where I am.
Lady, why are there no cucumber sandwiches? I ordered them specially for Aunt Augusta.
There were no cucumber sandwiches in the market today, sir. I went down twice.
No cucumbers?
No, sir, not even for ratty money.
That'll be all day.
And I would like to be allowed to take advantage of Lady Bracknell's temporary absence.
I certainly would advise you to do so. Mama has a way of coming back suddenly into a room that I often have to speak to her about.
Miss Fairfax, I have admired you more than any girl I have ever met since I met you.
I'm quite aware of that, Mr. Worthing. And I have often wished that in public at any rate. Maybe more demonstrative. For me, you have always had an irresistible fascination. Even before I met you, I knew I was far from indifferent to you. We live, as I hope you know, in an age of ideals. And my ideal has always been to love someone of the name of Earnest. There is something in the name that inspires absolute confidence. The moment Algernon first mentioned to me that he had a friend by the name of Earnest, I knew I was destined to love you.
You really love me, Gwendolyn?
Passionately.
Darling, you don't know how happy you've made me.
My own Earnest.
But that's not to say that you couldn't love me if my name wasn't Earnest, could you?
But your name is Earnest.
Yes, but supposing that my name was not Earnest, you would still love me then.
That is clearly a metaphysical speculation. And like most metaphysical speculations, has very little reference, if any at all, to the actual facts of real life as we know them.
And really, Gwendolyn, I don't think the name Earnest suits me at all.
It suits you perfectly. It is a divine name. It has a music of its own, produces vibrations.
Really, Gwendolyn, I think there are much nicer names out there. Names like Jack, I think, a perfectly charming name.
Jack? No. There is no character music in the name of Jack, really at all. It does not thrill. It produces absolutely no vibrations. And I have known several Jacks, and each one without exception has been usually playing. Besides, Jack is notorious domesticity for John. I did to any woman married to a man called John. She would probably never be allowed to know the entrancing pleasure of a single moment's solitude. The really only safe name is Earnest.
Gwendolyn, I must get christened at once. Oh, yeah. Oh, I mean that we must get married at once.
Married, Mr. Worthing?
Well, yes. You know that I love you, and led me to believe that you were not as indifferent to me as I was you.
I adore you, Mr. Worthing, but you have not proposed yet. Nothing has been said at all about marriage. The subject has not even been touched on.
Well, may I propose to you now?
I think it's an admirable idea, and to spare you any possible disappointment, I think it's only fair to tell you quite beforehand I'm fully determined to accept. Yes, Mr. Worthing? What have you got to say to me?
Well, you know what I've got to say to you.
Yes, but you didn't say it.
Gwendolyn, will you marry me?
Certainly. How long have you been about it? I'm afraid you have had very little practice in how to propose.
My own one, I've never loved anybody in the world but you.
Yes, but men often propose to practice. I know my brother Gerald does. All my girlfriends tell me so. Blue eyes you have, Ernest. They are quite, quite blue. I hope you always look just like that, especially when we are in the presence of other people. Mr. Worthing! Why, sir, from the semi-recumbent position, it is most indecorous. Ma, I must ask you to retire. Mr. Worthing is not quite finished yet.
Not finished what, may I ask?
Oh, I'm engaged to be married to Mr. Worthing.
Pardon me, but you are not engaged to anyone. When you do become engaged, either myself or your father, self-permitting, shall inform you of the fact.
An engagement should come upon a young lady as a surprise, pleasant or unpleasant as the case may be. It is hardly a thing she should be allowed to arrange for herself. Now, I have a few questions to pose to you, Mr. Worthing.
Gwendolyn, if I may, can I increase your weight to be below in the carriage?
For more?
In the carriage, Gwendolyn. Gwendolyn, the carriage.
Yes, ma'am. You have a seat, Mr. Worthing.
No, thank you, Lady Bracknell. I prefer standing.
I feel obliged to tell you you are not down upon my list of eligible young gentlemen. However, I suppose I could place you upon this list if your answers are what a truly attentive mother requires. Tell me. Smoke?
Well, yes, I must admit that I do smoke.
I'm glad to hear it. A young man should always have an occupation. There are far too many idle men in London these days.
How old are you?
49.
Oh, a very good age to be married at. Now, I'm of the opinion, Mr. Worthing, that when a man wishes to be married, he should either know everything or nothing. Which do you know?
The only people that I see, dear, are the poachers.
Country house? How many bedrooms? Well, I suppose that matter will be cleared up later. You do have a townhouse, I hope. You could hardly expect a girl with a simple and spoilt nature like Gwendolyn to reside in the country.
Well, yes, in Belgrave Square, in fact. It is let out by the year to the old Lady Blossom. But I can get it back whenever I like. At 6 months' notice.
I don't know her.
She's a lady considerably advanced in years. She goes about very little.
What number in Belgrave Square?
149.
The unfashionable side. I thought there was something. However, I suppose that could easily be remedied.
Fashion or the side?
Both, if necessary, I presume. What are your politics?
I really have none. I'm a liberal unionist.
Oh, they count as Tories, they die with us. Now to minor matters. Tell me, Mr. Worthing, are your parents living?
I have lost both my parents.
To lose one parent, Mr. Worthing, may be regarded as misfortune. To lose both, however, looks like carelessness.
Pity, Bracknell. It would be near the truth for me to say that it seems my parents have lost me. I was found.
Found?
Yes. Old Mr. Thomas Cardew, who found me, gave me the name of Worthing because he happened to have a first-class ticket to Worthing in his pocket. It is a seaside resort in Sussex.
And where did this charitable gentleman with a first-class ticket to a seaside resort happen to find you?
In a handbag.
A handbag?
A very large black leather handbag with handles attached to it. A very ordinary handbag at that.
And in what locality did this Mr. James or Thomas Cardew happen to come across this ordinary handbag?
The cloakroom at the Victorian Station.
The cloakroom at Victoria Station?
The Brighton line.
The line is immaterial! Mr. Worthing, I must confess I feel somewhat bewildered by what you've just told me. To be born, or at any rate bred, in a handbag seems to show a certain disregard for the very common decencies of family life, and reminds me of some of the worst excesses of the French Revolution. I presume you know what that little movement led to. Nurse for the particular locality in which the handbag was found, and cloakroom at a railway station may serve to conceal certain social indiscretions. Indeed, it's probably been used for such devices before now, but it could hardly be seen as an assured basis for a recognized position in good society.
Well then, what do you propose that I do, Lady Bracknell? I need hardly say I would do anything to ensure Gwendolyn's happiness.
I would strongly advise you, Mr. Worthing, to acquire some relations as soon as possible, and to produce at any rate one parent of either sex before the season is quite over.
How do you expect that I'd do that? I can produce the handbag at any moment. It is at my place in the dressing room. That should satisfy you, Lady Bracknell.
Me, sir? What is it to do with me? You could hardly imagine myself and Lord Bracknell would dream of allowing our only daughter, a girl brought up with the utmost care, to marry into a cloakroom and form an alliance with a parcel. Good morning, Mr. Worthing.
Oh, for God's sake, Sally, quit playing that ghastly tune! How idiotic you are!
Didn't go all right, old boy? I don't mean to say that Gwendolyn refused you. It's a way she has. She's always refusing people. It's so very ill-natured of her.
Oh, Gwendolyn is as bright as a trivet, but her mother is perfectly unbearable. I've never met such a Gorgon. Though I've never met a Gorgon, but if there was one, she at any rate, she is a monster. I beg your pardon, Algie. I don't think you'd like to hear your own relations abused like this.
My dear fellow, I love hearing my relations abused. It's the only thing that makes me put up with them at all.
You don't seem to think Gwendolyn will become anything like her mother in about 150 years.
All women become like their mother. That is a tragedy. No man does. That is his. By the way, did you tell Gwendolyn about you being Earnest in town and Jack in the country?
My dear fellow, the truth is not the sort of thing that one tells to a sweet, refined girl like Gwendolyn. What ideas you have about how to behave to a woman?
The only way to behave to a woman is to make love to her if she is pretty, or to someone else if she is quite plain.
That is nonsense.
What about your brother? Or what about the problem is Earnest?
Oh, by the end of the week, I will say my poor brother Ernest has been suddenly carried off to Paris by a severe chill. That gets rid of him.
Oh, but what about Miss Cardew? Didn't you say that she was a little too attached to your brother Ernest? Won't she feel his loss a good deal?
Cecily is not a silly, romantic girl, I'm glad to say. She has a capital appetite, goes on long walks, and pays no attention to her studies.
Well, I would never like to see you, Cecily.
I'll take very good care that you never do. She's excessively pretty and just 18.
Have you told Gwendolyn that you have an excessively pretty ward who is just 18?
My dear fellow, that again is not the sort of thing one blurts out to a very nice, sweet, and romantic girl like Gwendolyn. At any rate, by the time they have met each other, after half an hour passed, they will be calling each other sister.
We need only do that. I think we are calling each other a lot of other things first. Now, if you want to go to the table at Wilson's, you must come and rest. Do you realize it is almost nearly 7?
Miss Fairfax.
It depresses me so much. should meet.
I suppose so, but it seems very unfair. And was your novel ever published?
Alas, no. The manuscript was abandoned. I use the word in the sense of lost or mislaid. But to your work, child, these speculations, the prophetess.
Oh, but I see a dear Dr. Chasuble coming up through the garden.
Dr. Chasuble, this is such a good pleasure.
Good morning, Miss Prism. I trust you are well.
Miss Prism has just been complaining of a slight headache. I think it would do her so much good to have shot stroll the park with you, Dr. Chasuble.
Cecily, I don't know if you really feel about a headache.
No, dear Miss Prism, I know that, but I felt instinctively that you had a headache. Indeed, I was thinking about that and not about my German lessons when the rector came along.
Cecily, I hope you're not inattentive.
Oh, I'm afraid I am.
Well, that is strange. Were I fortunate enough to be one of Miss Prism's pupils, I would hang upon her lips. but I spoke metaphorically. My metaphor was drawn from ease. But I must not disturb a cheerier and her pupil any longer.
Cheerier? My name is Letitia, Doctor.
Oh, a classical illusion, merely, drawn from the pagan authors. But I have no doubt see both as even so.
I think, Doctor, that I will have a stroll with you. I find I had a headache after all, and a walk might do it some good. Cecily, in my absence, you will study your political economy. The chapter on the fall of the rupee, you may omit. It is somewhat too sensational. Even these metallic problems have their melodramatic side.
Horrid political economy. Horrid geography. Horrid German.
Mr. Earnest Worthing has just driven home from the station. He has brought his luggage with him.
Mr. Earnest Worthing before the album. Uncle Jack's brother. Did you tell him Mr. Worthing was in town?
Yes, miss. He seemed very much disappointed. I mentioned that you and Miss Prism were in the garden. He said he was anxious to speak to you privately for a moment.
Ask Mr. Worthing to come here, and I suppose you'd better talk to the housekeeper about getting a room for him.
Very good, miss.
I have never met a really wicked person. I feel rather frightened. I'm so afraid you look just like everyone else. He does.
It must be my little cousin Cecily, I am sure.
You are under some strange mistake. I'm not little. In fact, I believe I'm more than usually tall for my age. But I am your cousin Cecily, and you, I see from your card, are Uncle Jack's brother, my cousin Ernest, my wicked cousin Ernest.
You mustn't think that I am wicked. I'm not really wicked at all, cousin Cecily.
If you are not, then you certainly have been deceiving us all in a very inexcusable manner. I hope you have not been leading a double life, pretending to be wicked and really being good all the time. That would be hypocrisy.
Of course, I have been rather reckless.
I'm glad to hear it.
Now that you mention the subject, I have been very bad in my own small way.
I don't think you should be proud of that, though I'm sure it must have been very pleasant.
Oh, it is much pleasanter being here with you.
I don't understand you being here at all. Uncle Jack won't be back until Monday afternoon.
Oh, that is a great disappointment. I'm obliged to take the first train on Monday morning. I have a business appointment that I am anxious to miss.
Couldn't you miss it anywhere but in London?
Oh, no, the appointment is in London.
Oh, well, I know how important it is not to keep a business from it. If one wants to retain any sense of beauty of life, though I think you'd better wait till Uncle Jack arrives. I know you want to speak to about your immigrating.
About my what?
Your immigrating. He's gone up to buy your outfit.
I certainly won't let Jack buy my outfit. There's no place in that at all.
I don't think you will require any size. Uncle Jack is sending you to Australia.
Australia? I'm soon to die.
Well, you said at dinner on Wednesday night that you would have to choose between this world, the next world, and Australia.
Very well. The accounts that I've received of Australia and the next world are particularly encouraging. This life is good enough for me, Cousin Cecily.
Yes, but are you good enough for it?
I'm afraid that I am not that. That is why I want you to reform me. You may make that your mission if you don't mind, Cecily.
I'm afraid I have no time for Cecily.
Would you mind me reforming myself this afternoon?
It is rather quixotic of you, but I think you should try.
I will. I feel better already.
You're looking a little worse.
Oh, well, that is because I am hungry.
Oh, how thoughtless of me. I must remember that whenever one is going to eat the entire way we love, one requires regular and wholesome meal. Welcome in.
Oh, thank you, but why do I have a buttermilk first? I can't have an appetite unless I have a buttermilk first.
A carnation?
Oh, no. I'd sooner have a pink rose.
Why?
Because you are a pink rose, that's Cecily.
I don't think you should talk to me like that. This prison never says such things to me.
Oh, this prison is just like an old lady. You are the prettiest girl that I've ever seen.
This prison is also looks like a snare.
A snare that every sensible man would be caught in.
I don't think I would care to catch a sensible man. I wouldn't know what to talk to him about.
I do not deserve so neologistic a phrase. The precept, as well as the practice of the primitive church, was distinctly against matrimony.
That is obviously the reason why the primitive church has not lasted up to the present day. And you do not seem to realize that he adopted the fact of persistently remaining single. A man converts himself into a permanent public plantation. This very celibacy leads weaker vessels astray.
But is a man not equally attractive when married?
No married man is ever attractive. Then he presents to his wife.
And often, I've been told, not even the third.
It depends on the intellectual sympathies of the woman. Maturity can be trusted on. Roughness can be trusted. Young women are greedy. I spoke horticulturally. My metaphor was drawn from fruits. But where is Cecily?
Oh, perhaps she found this in the school.
Mr. Worthing!
Mr. Worthing?
We did not call you till Monday afternoon.
Mr. Worthing, I trust this garb of woe does not betoken some terrible calamity. My brother.
More shameful debts and extravagance.
Saving his life with pleasure.
Dead.
Your own priest.
Dead? Quite dead.
What a lesson for him. I trust that he will profit by it.
Mr. Worthing, you have my sincere condolence. You have at least the consolation of knowing that you were always the most generous and forgiving of brothers.
Poor Earnest, he had many faults, but it is a sad, sad girl.
Very sad indeed. Were you with me at the end?
No. He died abroad, in Paris, in fact. I had a telegraph from the manager of the Grand Hotel last night.
Was the cause of death mentioned?
Severe chill, it seems.
As man sows, so let him reap.
Charity, dear Mrs. Prison, charity. None of us are perfect. I myself am particularly susceptible to drafts. But will things happen to take place here?
Oh, no. He desired to be buried in Paris.
Paris?
I feel that powder points to any very serious state of mind at the last.
But you would no doubt wish me to make some slight allusion to this tragic domestic affliction next Sunday. After all, my sermon on the meaning of Marla in the wilderness can be adapted to almost any occasion. Joyful or in this present case, stress. I've preached at harvest celebrations, christenings, confirmations, and on days of humiliation and festivals. In fact, the last time I delivered my sermon was as a charity sermon for the Society of the Prevention of Discontent among the upper orders. Yes, the bishop, who was present, was much struck by some of the analogies I drew.
Oh, that reminds me. You do know how to christen all right, I suppose. Well, I mean that you are continually christening, aren't you?
It
It is, I regret to say, one of the rector's most constant duties in this parish. I have often spoken to the poor classes about the matter, but they don't seem to know what the thrift is.
Is there any particular infant in which you are interested, Mr. Worthing?
Your brother was, I believe, unmarried, was he not?
Oh, yes. But you see, dear doctor, I would like to be christened myself, if there's no problem in that.
The sprinkling and indeed immersion of adults is a perfectly canonical practice.
Immersion?
You really have no apprehensions, Mr. Worthing. Sprinkling is all that is necessary. Or indeed, I would be advisable. Our weather here is so changeable. What time do you wish to ceremony?
Oh, I might trot around about 5 if that suits you.
Perfectly, perfectly. In fact, I have 2 similar ceremonies to perform at that time. A case of twins that occurred recently in one of the outlying cottages on your own estate.
Poor Jenkins the Carter, a most hard-working man. That would be absurd, getting christened along with another baby. It would just be childish. Would 5:30 do?
Admirably, admirably. But I will not intrude any longer into this house of sorrow. I would just ask that you not be bowed down too much by grief. After all, what seem to us bitter trials are often blessings in disguise.
This seems to me to be a blessing in an extremely obvious kind. Cecily!
Dear child!
Uncle Jack, you look happy. You look as though you have a toothache. And I have such a surprise for you. Who do you think is in the dining room? Your brother.
Who?
Your brother. He arrived about 30 minutes ago.
That is nonsense. I do not have a brother.
Please don't say that, Uncle Jack. However badly he may have behaved to you in the past, he is still your brother. You couldn't be so hot as to disown him. I will go and get him. You will shake hands with him, won't you, Uncle Jack?
These are very joyful tidings.
After being all resigned to his loss, his sudden return seems to me particularly distressing.
My brother is in the dining room. I don't know what this all means. It seems to me to be perfectly absurd. Oh, good God.
Brother John. Up from town to tell you that I am terribly sorry for the trouble that I have caused you, and that I plan to live a better life in the future.
Uncle Jack, you aren't going to refuse your brother's hand.
Nothing will induce me to taking his hand. His coming down is perfectly disgraceful, and he knows well why.
Uncle Jack, do be nice. There is some good in everyone. Ernest has just been telling me about his poor invalid friend, Mr. Bunger, whom he goes to visit so often. I'm sure that there is much good in someone who kind to the figure, and it's the pleasures of London to sit by a bed of hay.
He has been talking to you about Bunbury, has he?
Yes, he's told me all about poor Mr. Bunbury. Terrible thing, Pat.
Well, I will not have him talking to you any more about poor Mr. Bunbury. It is enough to drive one perfectly frantic.
I admit all the faults were on my side. But I find Ben John's clothes to be particularly painful. I didn't feel more enthusiastic welcome. Especially considering this is the first time that I've ever been here.
Uncle Jack, if you don't shake hands with Ernest, I will never forgive you.
Never forgive me?
Never, never, never.
Well then, it is the last time that I shall ever do so.
It's pleasant, is it not, to see so perfect a reconciliation? But we should leave these two brothers alone.
Cecily, it's time for you to change the tea.
Certainly.
You young scoundrel, Algy! You must get out of this place at once. I do not know any Bunbury here.
I have put Mr. Ernest Worthing's luggage into the room next to yours, sir. I suppose that is all right.
What?
His luggage. I've unpacked it and put it into the room next to yours.
His luggage?
Yes, sir. 3 portmanteaus, 2 dressing cases, a hat box, and a large luncheon basket.
I'm afraid I won't be able to stay for a week this time.
I beg your pardon, sir. There's an elderly gentleman who wishes to see you.
See me?
Yes, sir.
know anything about them. Who are they?
Parker and Grisby. I wonder, my dear Earnest, if he could be here for your friend, Mr. Bunbury. I expect that he would like to make his will and wishes to be your executor. Show the man in at once.
Very good, sir.
I hope I may rely on the statements you told me last week and that I had settled all of your debts for you and that you have no outstanding accounts of any kind.
I haven't even told you, Jack. But it's your generosity, I don't know.
I'm sincerely glad to hear it.
Mr. Chris.
Mr. Sparley.
This is Mr. Sparley.
Mr. Sparley.
Yes.
Of B40 Aldrin.
Yes, that is my address.
I am sorry, sir, but we have a writ of attachment against you at the suit of the Savoy Hotel Company for 20 days. And limited for £762, 14 shillings, and tuppence.
Well, that is perfectly absurd. I never dined at Savoy. I always dined at Willis's. It is far more expensive. I don't owe a penny to the Savoy.
The writ is marked as having been served on you personally at the Albany on May 27th. Judgment was given in default against you on the 5th of June. Since then, we have written you no less than 15 times. Without receiving any reply. In the interest of our clients, we had no option but to obtain an order for the committal of your person.
Committal? What on earth do you mean by committal? I haven't the smallest intention of going away. I'm staying here for a week. I'm staying with my brother. And if you imagine that I'm going to town the moment that I arrive, you are extremely mistaken.
I am merely a solicitor myself, but I do not employ personal violence of any kind. However, the officer of the court, whose function is to seize the person of the debtor, is waiting in the fly right outside. But no doubt you will prefer to pay the bill.
Pay it? How on earth do you suppose that I pay it? You don't think that I have any money? A gentleman never has any money.
In my experience, it is usually relations who pay.
Jack, who has really settled this bill for me?
Kindly allow me to see the particulars, Mr. Grimsby.
Yes, sir.
£762, 14 shillings, and tuppence. Well, I can quite candidly say that I have never seen such reckless extravagance in all my life.
£762 for eating? There can be little good in any young man who eats so much and so often.
We are far from Wordsworth's plain living and high thinking.
Now, Dr. Chasuble, do you suppose that I am called upon in any way to call and pay this monstrous account for my brother?
Indeed, I do not think so. It would be increasing his extravagant habit.
I must say that I think this proposed incarceration most salutary. As man sows, so let him reap. It is to be regretted that it is only for 20 days.
I am quite of your opinion.
How ridiculous you are! You know perfectly well this bill is really yours.
Why?
Yes, you know it is.
Mr. Worthing, if this is a jest, it is particularly out of place.
It is gross effrontery.
And it is an ingratitude. I did not expect that.
Oh, never mind what he says. He always goes on this way. You mean now to say that you are not Mr. Ernest Worthing, residing at B4 the Albany? While you are at it, I would not suppose you do not deny being my brother at all.
Of course I'm not going to do that, my dear fellow. You know perfectly well that I am your brother. Well, that's why you should really settle this bill for me.
I can tell you quite candidly that I have not the smallest intention of doing anything of that kind. Dr. Chapel, who is worthy rector of this parish, and Miss Prism, who I rely great and sound judgment in, are both of the opinion that incarceration would do you a great deal of good. And I am quite of their opinion.
I am sorry to disturb this pleasant family meeting, but time presses. We have to leave the hallway no later than 4 o'clock. Otherwise, it is difficult to obtain admission.
Holloway?
Yes, it is at the Holloway that the detentions of this character will take place.
Well, I am really not going to be imprisoned in the suburbs, but I can die in the West End.
The bill is for suppers, not dinners.
Well, I really don't care. All I said is that I'm not going to be imprisoned in the suburbs.
The surroundings itself are middle class, but the prison itself is fashionable and well-ed. There are ample opportunities of taking exercise, doing certain stated hours of the day, and in case of medical certificates, which is always easy to obtain, the hours can be extended.
Exercise? Good heavens! You don't suppose that a gentleman takes exercise? You don't seem to realize what a gentleman is.
No, I'm afraid I don't. There are curious varieties of them, results of cultivation, no doubt. But kindly come out now, if it will not be inconvenient for him.
Chuck!
Pray be firm, Mr. Worthing.
This is a time where any weakness may be a form of self-deception.
I am firm, and I don't know what kind of weakness or self-deception of any time is.
Uncle Jack, I think you've a little money of mine, haven't you? Let me pay the bill. I wouldn't like it if your own brother was shut up.
Oh, I could not possibly allow you to do that.
Then you will, won't you? I don't think you would like it if you thought your own brother was in prison. Of course, I am quite disappointed in him.
Never talk to him again?
Certainly not. Unless, of course, he speaks to me first. It would be very rude not to answer him.
Well, I will take very good care he does not speak to you or to anybody in this house ever again. The man should be cut. Mr. Crispy?
Yes, sir?
I shall pay this bill for my brother. And it is the last bill I shall ever pay for him, too.
I must say that I think such generosity quite foolish.
The head has its wisdom as well as the heart, Mr. Crispy.
How much is it?
£762, 14 shillings, and tuppence. The cab will be 5 and 9 pence extra. Paid for the convenience of the client.
All right. Able to Parker and Grimsby, I suppose?
Yes, sir. Kindly don't cross the check. Thank you, sir. Good day. Mr. Weller, I hope I shall have the pleasure of meeting you again.
I sincerely hope not. What ideas you have of the sort of society that a gentleman would want to mix in? No gentleman wants to know what's a visitor that wants to go to prison body in the suburbs.
Quite so.
By the way, Grimsby.
Yes?
Grimsby, you are not to go back to the station in that cab. That is my cab. It was taken for my convenience. You've got to walk back to the station. Not a very bad thing, either. Solicitors don't walk nearly enough. I don't know any solicitor who takes sufficient exercise. As a rule, they sit in stuffy offices all day, neglecting their business.
Mr. Grimsby, you can take the cab.
Thank you, sir.
Merriman, order the dog cart at once. It seems that Mr. Worthing has been suddenly called back to town.
Very good, sir.
What is it about you, Jack? I haven't been called at all.
Yes, you have.
I haven't heard anybody call me.
Your duties as a gentleman calls you back to town.
My duties as a gentleman have never interfered with my pleasures in the smallest degree.
Yes, I can see that.
Well, certainly is a darling.
You are not to talk of Miss Cardew like that. I do not like it.
Well, I don't like your clothes. You look perfectly ridiculous. Could you go and change? You seem to have thought that you were in mourning for a man such as staying with you in your house as a guest for a whole week.
You are not staying in my house for a whole week as a guest or as anything else. You must leave by the 4:05 train.
I can't leave you while you're in mourning. That would be most unkind. If I were in mourning, you would stay with me, I suppose. And if you didn't, I'd find it most unfriendly.
Well then, will you leave if I change my clothes?
Yes, but you must be quick about it. I've never seen anybody take so long to dress. With such little resort.
Well, it is better than being so always
overdressed as you are. If I'm occasionally a little overdressed, I make up for it by being immensely overeducated.
Your vanity is ridiculous! Your conduct is an outrage, and your being here is perfectly absurd! You must leave by the 4:05 train! This bunburying, as you call it, has not been a very great success!
Well, I think it's been a great success. I love Cecily. This is the only thing that matters. Cecily.
dog cart is waiting, sir.
Tell the dog cart to come round next week at the same hour.
Very good, sir.
Uncle Jack would be very much annoyed if he knew you were staying on till next week at the same hour.
And I don't really care about Jack. I don't care about anybody else in the whole entire world. Except for you. I love you, Cecily. You will marry me, won't you?
Of course. But we have been engaged for the last 3 months.
For the last 3 months?
Yes, it'll be exactly 3 months this Thursday.
But what about like they're being engaged?
Well, ever since Uncle Jack first confessed that he had a brother, which is very wicked and bad, you, of course, became the chief topic of the conversation between myself and Miss Pizza. Surely someone who's always much talked about is very attractive. One feels there's something in him after all. I dare say it was foolish of me. I fell in love with you, Alice.
Darling, and when will the engagement actually settle?
On 14th of February last, worn out by my entire ignorance of myself, I decided to end the matter one way or another, and with a long struggle, I accepted you under this dear old tree here. The next day, I bought this little ring in your name, the true lover's knot, I promised you always to wear.
Did I buy you this? It's very pretty, isn't it?
Yes, you have wonderfully good taste, Ernest. It is the excuse I have always given you for you leading such a bad life. And this is the box that I kept all your dear letters.
My letters? But my own sweet, darling little Cecily, I have never written you any letters.
You can hardly remind me of that, Ernest. I remember only 2 hours, forced to write your letters for you. I wrote 3 times a week and sometimes not for
them. Do let me see this!
I think possibly. They would make it far too conceited. Here you wrote me after I broke off the engagement. So beautiful. So badly spelled. Now, all you did was her cry.
Was the engagement ever broken off?
Of course it was. On the 22nd of last month. You can see the entry if you like. Today I broke off the engagement with Ernest. I feel obliged to do so. The weather still continues to come.
Why did you break it off? What have I done? I have done nothing, Cecily. I'm very hurt indeed to hear that you broke it off. Especially considering the weather was so charming.
You have hardly been a very serious man, and it has been broken off at least once. But I accept you have to leave for that.
Oh, a perfect angel you are!
Dear romantic boy, I hope your hair grows naturally, does it?
Oh, yes. With a little help from others.
I'm glad to hear it.
You will never break off the engagement again, will you, Cecily?
Of course not, now that I have actually met you. Besides, there is the question of your name.
Oh, yes, of course.
You must not laugh at me, darling, but it has always been a girlish dream of mine to love someone whose name was Earnest. One feels there is something in that name that inspires absolute confidence.
But you don't mean to say that you couldn't love me if I had some other name.
What other name?
Oh, any name you like. Algernon, for instance.
Oh, no. I don't like the name Algernon.
I don't see why you should object to the name of Algernon. It is a very aristocratic name. A half of the chaps that go into bankruptcy court with the name of Algernon. Oh, seriously, Cecily. You couldn't love me if I had the name of Algy?
I might respect you. I might admire your character. But I fear I cannot give you my undivided attention.
Your rector is, I presume, thoroughly experienced in the rites and ceremonials of the church?
Dr. Chasuble is a most learned man. He has never written a single book, so you can imagine how much he knows.
I must see him at once on an important christening. I mean on some important business.
Oh.
I shall be away more than half an hour.
Considering that we have been engaged since February 14th, and since I have only met you today for the first time, I think it's rather hard that you should leave me for such a long period as half an hour. Would you make it 20 minutes?
I'll be back in good time.
Oh, it would have been courteous for you. My life is here so much. I must enter this proposal into my diary.
Fairfax has called to see Mr. Worthing on very important business, Miss Fairfax states.
Is it Mr. Worthing in his library?
Mr. Worthing went over in the direction of the rectory some time ago.
Ask Miss Fairfax to come here. Uncle Jack will be back soon, and you can bring tea.
Yes, miss.
I suppose one of the many elderly women who are associated with Uncle Jack in some of his philanthropic work. I should really like women who are interested in philanthropic work. So forward of them.
Miss Fairfax.
Hey, let me introduce myself to you. My name is Cecily Cardew.
Cecily Cardew? It's a very sweet name. I'm so great friends. I like your room more than I can say. My first impressions of you are never wrong.
How nice of you to like me so much after we've known each other for such a comparatively short time. Please sit down.
I may call you Cecily, may I not?
With pleasure.
And you always call me Gwendolyn, don't you?
If you wish.
Then it is all quite.
When I see a spade, I call a spade.
I'm glad to say I have never seen a spade. It is obvious our social skills have been widely different.
Shall I lay the tea here as usual?
Yes, as usual.
There are many interesting walks in the city, Miss Cardew.
Yes. From the top of one hill, one can see 5 counties.
5 counties? I don't think I should like that. I hate crowds.
I suppose this is why you live in towns, Fairfax. May I have you some tea?
Thank you. Detestable girl, but I require tea.
Sugar?
No, thank you. Sugar is not fashionable anymore.
Cake or bread and butter?
Bread and butter, please. Cake is rarely seen in the best of houses nowadays.
Hand this to Miss Fairfax.
I could deny it if I like. I could deny anything. But my name is John, and it has been John for years.
My poor wounded Cicely! My sweet robes, Gwendolyn! You will call me sister, will you not?
Yes. There's just one question that I would like to be allowed to ask, my guardian.
An admirable idea. Mr. Worthing, there's just one question. I would like to be permitted to watch you. Where is your brother Earnest? We are both engaged to be married to your brother Earnest. Great importance to know where he was at present.
Gwendolyn? Cecily? It is very painful for a man to have to be speaking the truth. It is not the sort of position one would like to find himself in. But I must speak quite frankly to you. I do not have a brother, and I have never had a brother of any kind, and I do not intend of having a brother of any kind in the future.
No brother at all?
No brother of any kind?
Not of any kind.
It is clear that neither one of us is engaged to be married to anyone.
It's a terrible situation for a woman to find herself in.
Let's stay in the house. They will hardly venture to come after us there.
No, men are still cowardly, aren't they?
Bunbury, I suppose?
Oh, yes. That was a perfectly wonderful Bunbury. It is, too. In fact, it's one of the most wonderful Bunburys I've ever had.
You're right to Bunbury in this place.
That is absurd. Only Bunbury wherever one chooses. Every serious Bunbury is good for
that. Oh, serious Bunburys? Good God!
One must have something to be serious about in life if one wants to have any enjoyment in life. I happen to be very serious about Bunbury.
Well, the only small satisfaction about this whole ordeal is that your friend, Mr. Bunbury, is quite exploded. You'll not be able to come down to the country as much as your wicked custom was, and not a bad thing, either.
Well, your brother is a little off color, isn't he, Jack? You won't be able to come as proud as often as your wicked custom was.
Not a very bad thing, either. As for your conduct towards Miss Cardew, you're taking in a sweet, single girl. Is quite inexcusable. Say nothing of the fact that she is my ward.
Well, I can see no defense in deceiving her. Clever, brilliant, thoroughly experienced, a young lady, such as Miss Fairfax. Say nothing of the least that she is my cousin.
I simply wanted to be engaged to Gwendolyn, that is all. I actually love her.
Well, I simply wanted to be engaged to Cecily. I adore her.
Well, I don't seem to think there's any likelihood of you forming an alliance with my ward.
Well, my dear Jack. I don't think there's much likelihood that you and Miss Fairfax will ever be united.
Well, that is none of your business.
If it was my business, I wouldn't talk about it. It's very bold to talk about one's own business. The only stockbrokers do that. You merely dinner parties.
How? You can sit there, calmly eating muffins, under this ghastly state of things I cannot possibly comprehend. It seems to me to be perfectly heartless.
Well, I can't eat muffins in an agitated manner. I'm holding the butter on my pot. The only way to eat muffins is quite calmly.
Yes, but that is no reason why you should be eating them at all. It seems to me to be perfectly heartless.
Well, when I'm in trouble, eating is the only thing that consoles me. Indeed, when I'm in great trouble, as anyone who knows me intimately will tell you, I refuse everything except fruit and drink. And at the present moment, I'm eating muffins because I am very unhappy. And besides, I am particularly fond of muffins.
Yes, but that is no reason why you should be eating them in that greedy manner at all.
No, no, Jack, I wish you would have some tea cake. I don't like tea cake.
I suppose a man may have his own muffins in his own garden.
But you just said it was perfectly heartless to eat muffins.
I said it was perfectly heartless of you. Given the circumstances, that is a completely different matter.
Oh, well, that is nonsense. Muffins are the same.
As John, I do not want you here.
Well, I can't leave right now. I'm not having dinner. I never go anywhere without having any dinner. No one ever does. Except vegetarians and people like that. Besides, I have just made arrangements with Dr. Castle to be christened under the name of Earnest at 6:15.
My dear fellow, the sooner you give that up, the better. I have made arrangements
this morning with Dr. Chasuble to be christened under the name of Earnest. Gwendolyn would wish it. And at any rate, I have the perfect right to be christened. There's no recollection in my past of me ever being christened. And I think that would be extremely problematic. And so does Dr. Chasuble. You, on the other hand, you have been christened.
Yes, but I have not been christened in some years.
But you have been christened.
Quite so. So I know my constitution can stand it. If you don't think you can ever be christened, I dare say that it is very dangerous that you're venturing on it now. It might make you very unaware. And besides, you seem to have forgotten that someone very near Deep was carried off in Paris by a severe chill.
Yes, but you said yourself that severe chill is not hereditary.
It used to be, I know. But I dare say that it is now. Science is always making improvements in things.
That is nonsense.
Look, I really wish you wouldn't get up and mock it. I'm really fond of muffins, and there's only two left.
But I hate tea cake.
Then why do you offer it to be served to your guest? What ideas you have of hospitality.
Algernon, I have told you to go. I do not want you here. Why don't you go?
I haven't quite finished my tea yet. And besides, there's still one muffin left.
Would you take the word from me?
Sir,
and German varieties.
And I proudly think, I see. Though perhaps somewhat exciting for a young girl, I myself am not in favor of premature experiences. But come, Gwendolyn, the time approaches for our departure, we have not a moment to lose. As a matter of form, Mr. Worthing, I'd better ask if Miss Cardew has any little fortune.
She only has about £130,000 in the funds. That is all. So nice to have spoken with you, Lady Bracknell. Thank you for coming.
A moment, Mr. Worthing. £130,000 and in the funds. Miss Cardew seems to be a most attractive young lady down the time. Really, look at her. A few girls who are at age have any really solid qualities and could be there, I regret to say, in danger of services. Come over here. Pretty child. Your dress is sadly simple and your hair, almost as nature might have left it, but we can soon alter all of that. A really thoroughly experienced French maid produces a simply marvellous effect in a very short space of time. Indeed, I remember recommending one to young Lady Lansing, and after 3 months her own husband did not.
After 6 months, nobody knew her.
Kindly turn around, sweet child. No further side views whatever. Yes, quite as I expected. There are distinct social possibilities in your profile. Chin and pie. Style largely depends on the way the chin is worn, and they are worn very high, just of late. Algernon, there are distinct social possibilities in Miss Hardy's profile.
Oh, Cecily is the sweetest, dearest, prettiest girl in the whole world. I don't care two pins about social possibilities.
Never speak disrespectfully of society, Algernon. Only people that can't continue to do that. My dear, you will understand that Algernon has nothing but his debts to depend upon. But I do not approve of announcing their marriages. Why, when I married Lord Bracknell, I had no fortune of any kind, but I never dreamed for a moment of allowing that to stand in my way. Well, I suppose I must give my consent.
I think you want to do that.
Says he, may kiss me.
Thank you, Lady Bracknell, and you may address me as Aunt Augusta for the future. Thank you, Aunt Augusta.
The marriage, I think, had better take place quite soon.
Thank you, Aunt
Augusta.
I myself am not in favor of long engagements. They give couples the opportunity of finding out each other's character before marriage, which is something I've never done.
I beg your pardon, Lady Bracknell, but it was stated in Miss Cardew's grandfather's will that she cannot marry until she comes of age. And I do not give my consent.
Upon what grounds, may I ask? Algernon is an extremely, I may almost say ostentatiously eligible young man. He has nothing, but he looks everything. What more can one desire?
I fear that I may think that your nephew is quite untruthful.
Untruthful? My nephew Algernon? Impossible, for he graduated from Oxford.
I fear there can be no possible doubt about the matter. When I was gone to London on an important question of romance, he entered my house under the false pretense of being my brother. Under that assumed pretense, he consumed all of my tea and all of my muffins. What makes his conduct all the more of an outrage is that he knew all along that I had no brother of any kind.
Well, Mr. Wallet, after careful consideration, I have decided to entirely overlook my nephew's conduct to you.
Why, thank you, Lady Bracknell, but I still decline to give my consent.
Come here, dear. How old are you, dear?
Well, I'm really only 18, but I always meant to be 20 with going to evening parties.
You're quite right to be making some slight alteration. Indeed, a woman should never be entirely honest about her age. It looks so calculating. 18? Admitted to 20 at evening parties? Well, it will not be long before you do come of age, not free from the restraints of your tutelage. Therefore, I do not think the opinion of your guardian is a matter of any vital importance.
I beg your pardon again, but in Miss Cardew's grandfather's will, it was clearly stated that she does not come of age until she is 35.
To me, it does not seem to be such a grave objection. Why, London society is full of women of the very highest birth who have chosen to remain 35 for years.
entirely in your own hands. The moment that you consent to Gwendolyn in my marriage is the moment that I will give my consent for your nephew to form an alliance with my ward.
You must understand that what you propose is entirely out of the question.
Then a passionate celibacy is all that any of us can look forward to.
Not the destiny I propose, Gwendolyn. Algernon, of course, can decide for himself. But come, dear, we've missed five, if not already six trains. It's nothing more like expose us to comment on the platform.
Everything is quite ready for the christenings.
The christenings? So, is that not somewhat premature?
Both these gentlemen have expressed a desire for immediate baptism.
At this age? The idea is grotesque and irreligious, Algernon. And they bid you to be baptized. Lord Ruckner would be highly displeased if he knew this was the way in which you spent your time and money.
Am I to understand then that there are to be no christenings at all this afternoon?
As things are now, dear doctor, I do not think that would be of any practical value to either of us.
I'm grieved to hear such sentiments from you, Mr. Worthing. They say that the heretical views of the Anabaptists, views that I have completely refuted in four of my unpublished sermons. However, since your mood seems to be one particularly secular, I will return to the church at once. In fact, I have just been informed by the pew opener that for the last hour and a half, Miss Prism has been waiting for me in the vestry. I'm on my way to join her now.
Pray allow me to detain you for a moment. This matter may prove to be one of vital importance to both Lord Ruckner and myself. Tell me, was this Miss Prism a female of repellent aspect in any way connected with education?
She's the most cultivated of ladies, the very picture of respectability.
She's obviously the same person. May I ask what position she holds in your household?
I am a celibate, madam.
Dear Lady Ragnar, Miss Prism has been Miss Conju's esteemed governess for the past 3 years now.
Despite of what I hear of her, I must see her at once. Let her be sent for.
Well, she approaches.
I was told you expected me in the vestry at 10. I have been waiting for you there for an hour and three quarters.
Prism? Come here, Prism! Prism? Where is that baby?
28 years ago, Prism, you left Lord Ruckner's house,
number 104 of Grosvenor Street, in charge of a perambulator that contained a baby of the male sex. You never returned. A few weeks later, through the elaborate investigations of the Metropolitan Police, the perambulator was discovered standing by itself at midnight in a remote corner of Bayswater. It contained a manuscript of a three-volume novel of more than unusually revolting sentimentality. But the baby was not there. Prism, where is that baby?
Lady Bracknell, admit with shame that I do not know. On the morning of the day you mentioned, the day that is forever branded upon my memory, I prepared as usual to take the baby out in its perambulator. I also had with me a somewhat old, but capacious handwriting, which I intended to place a little fiction that I had written during my few unoccupied hours. During a moment of mental distraction, for which I can never forgive myself, I put the manuscript in the bassinet and the baby in the handbag.
And where did you deposit that handbag, Miss Prism?
Don't ask me, Mr. Worthing.
This is no matter of small importance to me. I must know where you placed that handbag.
I left it in the cloakroom of one of the larger railway stations in London.
What railway station?
Victoria? Brighton Line?
I must retire immediately. Wait a minute. You will wait for me.
You're not too long. I will wait here for you all my life.
Do
Bracknell?
I dare not even suspect Dr. Chasuble. I need hardly tell you that in families of high position, strange coincidences are not supposed to occur. They are hardly a thing.
Uncle Jackson, strangely agitated.
Your uncle has a very emotional nature.
It sounds like you're having an argument. I dislike arguments of any kind. They are always vulgar and often convincing.
But it has stopped.
I should arrive at somewhere, Surgeon.
The suspense is terrible. I do hope it will last.
Miss Prism, is this your handbag? Examine it carefully before you speak. The happiness of more than one life depends on your reply.
Well, appears to be mine. Yes, here is the injury it received from the upsetting of a Gower Street omnibus in younger and happier days, and here on the lining is the stain it received from the explosion of a temperance beverage. An incident that occurred at Leamington. And here on the lock are my initials. I'd forgotten that in an extravagant mood I'd had them placed there. Yes, the bag is undoubtedly mine. I'm delighted to have it so unexpectedly returned to me. It has been a great inconvenience going without it for all these years.
Miss Prism, more's restored to you than just the handbag. I was the baby placed in it.
You?
Yes. Mother!
Mr. Worthing! I am remarried.
I regret to say that is a serious blow, but who can cast a stone against one who is suffering? Mother, I forgive you!
Mr. Worthing, there has been some error. There is the lady who can tell you who you really are.
Lady Bracknell, I hate to seem inquisitive, but could you kindly inform me who I am?
I'm afraid the news I have to give you will not altogether please you. You see, you are the son of my poor sister, Mrs. Moncrief, and consequently, Algernon's elder brother.
Treat him with more respect in the future. You never want to treat him.